إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالًا كثيرًا ونساءً، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله. Indeed, the most truthful of speech is the book of Allah. وَخَيْرُ الْهَدْيِ هَدْيِ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمٍ. And the best guidance is the guidance of our beloved messenger Muhammad صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمٍ. وَشَرُّ الْأُمُورِ مُحْدَثَاتُهَا. And the worst of affairs are those things we newly invent into this religion of ours. وَكُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ. And everything we newly invent into this religion of ours is an innovation. وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ. And every innovation is misguidance and it leads astray. وَقُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. Every going astray and every misguidance is in the hellfire. ثُمَّ أَمَّا بَعْد. Brother Masood.
It's on.
No, it's not on. My voice is on. It's okay. Khair, inshallah. Amma ba'd. There are many things, as we mentioned in the last couple of weeks, that we shouldn't do in a hurry, yet we do them in a hurry with no calmness, no concern, no focus, no khushu'. We do it with anger and emotion, and many times this enters us down a path of sin and disobedience and the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we started on some of those areas. Do not hasten to get up after the prayer. Do your adhkar, say ayatul kursi, because the one who says it after every fard prayer, nothing prevents him or her from Jannah except that they're alive, they haven't died yet. At least say subhanallah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar 10 times each and the likes of these matters. When you do your prayers, do not rush them. Say them with sedateness, with humility, with khushu', saying the Fatiha as it should be recited, taking time in your ruku' and your sujood and your bowing and your prostration, because the one who doesn't fulfill these correctly, it's like they've stolen from their prayer. We said that we should not rush in our du'a, saying to Allah, da'autu, da'autu, falam yastajab li, that I made du'a, Allah didn't answer it, so you hasten to take matters into your own hands. We mentioned to not rush, to be quick or rush to speak or to talk, to think before you speak. To think before you speak so you don't say something you regret or something you have to apologize for. Saying only what is good or being silent. And there is more things we should not hasten to do. There is more things we should not hasten and hurry to do because this could lead us to disobedience and major sin and the displeasure of Allah. As a reminder, Sahal ibn Sa'ad, rahimahullah, he said that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-anatu min Allah wal-ajilatu min ash-shaytan. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in this authentic hadith, which is Hasan in Sunan of Tirmidhi, he said that clemency, mercy, this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but hastiness is from shaytan. And the Arab used to say as a common statement, Al-ajilatu ummu al-nadama, that hastiness is the mother of regret. Because when you hurry to do many things, all you have is your hindsight. It's in the past. And you can have a great cause or a big cause of regret for you for the rest of your life.
And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, خلق الإنسان من عجل سأريكم آياتي فلا تستعجلون. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the Quran, what means that man is created in haste, of haste. And I will show you my ayat. I will show you my signs, my lessons, my proofs, my evidences. So ask me not to hasten them. And at the basis of not hastening, of not hurrying things, is that you are patient and you accept the qadr of Allah. So we want to cover three more areas from the many areas we can cover to not be hasty in. And this one we will is seeking your knowledge, seeking ilm, getting the knowledge. And Ibn Sirin, rahimahullah, qala inna hadha al-ilm deen, fanzuru amman ta'khuduna deenakum. Rawahu Muslim. Ibn Sirin, rahimahullah, he mentions, he said, this knowledge is religion. Knowledge, the knowledge of the deen is religion. So consider from whom you receive your religion. And Muslim transmitted it. Imam al-Bukhari at the beginning of his Sahih collection of a hadith, he said, al-ilm qabla al-qawl wal-amal. He said, knowledge comes before speech and action. In this deen, when it comes to ibadah, you cannot act or speak until you have knowledge of how or what to act or speak on. But the one who is hasty, يَقُولُ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَعْلَمُ. The one who is hasty, he speaks before he knows. وَيُجِيبُ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَفْهَمُ. And he answers stuff before he understands. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من سلك طريقا يلتمس فيه علما سهل الله له طريقا إلى الجنة. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, whoever seeks a path upon which to seek knowledge of this deen, Allah will make the path for him or her to paradise easy. Will make an easy path for them to get to Jannah. Just for seeking that knowledge. And Anas ibn Malik, he narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, طلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم. He said that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the seeking of knowledge is a faridah. It is an obligation upon every Muslim, male and female, that they seek knowledge of their deen, so they don't speak or act without that knowledge to back it up. And Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, he reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبِدُ الْعِلْمِ أَنْتِزَاعًا يَنْتَزِعُهُ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَلَكِنْ يَقْبِدُ الْعِلْمِ بِقَبْدِ الْعُلَمَاءِ حَتَّى إِذَا لَمْ يَتْرُكْ عالما أن اتخذ الناس رؤوسا جهال فسئلوا فأفتوا بغير علم فضلوا وأضلوا. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in this authentic hadith in Sahih Muslim, he said, verily Allah will not take away knowledge by snatching it away from the people, but he's going to remove the knowledge from the earth by taking the ulama, by taking the scholars, by them dying, so that when he leaves no learned person. And we're seeing this happen with those who were so firm to always give you an answer with قال الله and قال رسول الله. You will have a time where the ignorant people will become taken as leaders. And then they will be asked to give religious verdicts or fatawa. And they will deliver them without knowledge. They will go astray and they will lead the other people astray. And I warn you, as we said, the statement of Ibn Sirin, what we said, be mindful of who you take your religion from, because this deen is knowledge. This deen is knowledge. So be mindful of who you take your deen from. Imam Malik, he said, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he was studying and learning and reading Surah Al-Baqarah for 8 years. And now we're just in a mindset of ihfad, ihfad, just memorize it and go on. No need to understand, no need to implement. Abdullah ibn Umar, 8 years just on Surah Al-Baqarah. Subhanallah, the patience that you need to not just hurry and say, I want to learn, I want to memorize. And then you think you have it all and you go and you try to implement it many times, doing it falsely. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said that the men amongst the companions used to take 10 ayat, learn them, memorize them, implement them before they would move on. Patient to study and fully understand before they moved on. Today, we have the tafsir, the hadith, the tafsir of the Quran, the hadith that we hear. But many want to interpret things on their own whim, without wanting to go back to the scholars, without wanting to go back to what Allah said, or His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, or what the companions said. We have so much tafsir of the Quran that comes from the words of a companion, from the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But we'll take a tafsir from some modern day person who doesn't refer back to the best of mankind. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Khayrun nas qarni," the best of mankind is my generation. Ibn Abbas, he has a tafsir of the Quran himself because he was blessed with the knowledge of it. So we must require this. We must require that we make ourselves be patient to learn this deen and not be hasty. Remembering the breadth of the knowledge is wide. And that the Prophet ﷺ, he said, "I've been sent with the Quran and something similar to it," meaning his sunnah. Imam al-Barrahari, he said, rahimahullah, "Islam is the sunnah and the sunnah is Islam. So do not be foolish and hasty to be like some of these groups that are forming nowadays with these ignorant leaders who will say that we follow the Quran, but we can't trust to follow the sunnah. This is ignorance. This is ignorance. This is stupidity. This is foolishness in the deen." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, "وَمَا يَنطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ." Allah said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's not telling you these ahadith or showing you how to pray and the likes of these matters from his own desires or thoughts or whims. It is but a revelation revealed. Everything the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said and did is wahi. It is revelation. Malik ibn Anas, in a merciful form, he reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ أَمْرَيْنْ لَمْ تَضِلُّ مَا تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِمَا كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَسُنَّةَ رَسُولِهِ." The Imam Malik, he narrates that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "As long as you hold on fast and tightly to these two things that I've left amongst you, you will never go astray. The Quran, the Book of Allah, and the Sunnah of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." So be patient and don't rush to get in. Many people just want to read and say, "Okay, I understand and I know," without looking at the whole picture of learning their deen. So be mindful who you take your deen from. Another category, my brothers and sisters in Islam, that we're hasty with is chasing wealth and provision, chasing money. Because sometimes, some people don't even need it. They want to chase it because they want more. Or there are those who are struggling and they are worried genuinely, but they get impatient with what Allah has decreed for them, so they turn to haram. Some have no patience in working hard to achieve the halal. They want what they want when they want it, and nothing can get in their way because this is what's made their happiness in their lives. So they go to the haram at any means. Allah says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقَصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, "And certainly we will test you. We will test you with something of fear and hunger and loss of wealth and loss of lives and loss of fruits. But give glad tidings to the sabireen, to those who are patient." The sabireen, they have patience, sabr. Sabr عند الصدمة الأولى, at the first stroke of that calamity. So when there is fear, any fear you have in your life of anything, it is a test from Allah. When you have hunger, even when it's wajib upon you during the month of Ramadan, for example, this is a test from Allah. When you have the loss of wealth, it is a test from Allah. When you have the loss of a loved one, it is a test from Allah. When you have the loss of provision and fruits, it is a test from Allah. So be patient, because when those who do not have their provisions, when they turn to haram, these are the hasty ones, not trusting that Allah will provide for them. Allah said, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرِجًا وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. Allah said, and whoever fears Allah, Allah will provide for him or her a way out of every situation. And Allah will give you provisions from where you would least expect it. From where you would least expect it. But this is the one who has taqwa, who fears Allah and keeps his duty to Allah, will not go to the haram even if it meant he had to live under the freeway in a cardboard box. This is who the one Allah will give a way out. And this is the one who will be successful. And Abi Umama, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, إن روح القدس نفث في روعي أن نفسا لن تموت حتى تستكمل أجلها وتستوعب رزقها فأجملوا في الطلب ولا يحملن أحدكم استباء الرزق أن يطلبه بمعصية فإن الله لا ينال ما عنده إلا بطاعته. Look at this hadith as a warning to all of us from the Abu Umama radiallahu anhu, he said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, verily, Jibreel, Ruh al-Qudus, the spirit, meaning Jibreel alayhi salam, he inspired in my mind. So he's saying that Jibreel inspired him. This is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's authentic hadith, that a soul will never die until it finishes its term and consumes its provision, what Allah wrote for him or her. Thus be graceful in seeking provision, and let none of you allow the delay of a provision to compel him to seek it by disobedience. Look at this, direct message to all of us. Let none of you who have not gotten what you want, gotten what you're wishing for, gotten what you think you need, gotten the provisions or the wealth or whatever you think that is due to you, let none of you who haven't gotten to that point be rushed to go and try and get it, by disobedience. Verily Allah does not grant what is with him but by obedience. Through the obedience, the ta'ah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will bless you. Allah will give you what is due to you. And Abi Hurayrata, and this hadith was sahih, and it was made authentic by Shaykh al-Albani, rahimahullah. Be mindful of that hadith. Disobedience. Don't rush to it trying to get the provision you think is yours. The only way you'll get the provision you want is by obedience. Don't be fooled when you do the haram and you get the wealth and you see your dollars and your bank account go up or your land increase. If it comes by haram, it is haram. Abu Hurairah, he narrates that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ طَيِّبٌ وَلَا يَقْبَلُ إِلَّا طَيِّبًا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ أَمَرَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ بِمَا أَمَرَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ أَمَرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ بِمَا أَمَرَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ فَقَالَ تَعَالَى يَا أَيُّهَا الرُّسُلُ كُلُوا مِنْ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَاعْمَلُوا صَالِحًا وَقَالَ تَعَالَى يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُلُوا مِنْ طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ ثُمَّ ذَكَرَ الرَّجُلَ يُطِيلُ الصَّفْحَ أَشْعَثَ وَأَغْبَرَ يَمُدُّ يَدَيْهِ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ يَا رَبِّ يَا رَبِّ وَمَطْعَمُهُ حَرَامٌ ومشربه حرام وملبسه حرام وغذي بالحرام فأن لا يستجاب له. This hadith which we have in the Sahih of Muslim, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah the Almighty is good and pure, and He only accepts what is good and pure. And verily Allah commanded the believers to do that which He commanded the messengers. So the Almighty has said, what means, O you messengers, eat of the tayyibat, eat of all the legal halal foods, and perform righteous deeds. And the Almighty has said, O you who believe, eat of the lawful things that we have provided for you. Then he mentioned the case of a man who was on a long travel, he was on a long journey, and he was disheveled and dirty and dusty, and he spread his hands begging Allah, facing them towards the heavens. And he called upon Allah, Ya Rabb, my Lord, my Lord. But his food was haram, and his drink was haram, and his clothing was haram, and he nourished himself with haram. So how can his prayer, how can this supplication be answered? We know that the dua for the one who is traveling is mustajab, it is answered for the traveler when they make dua. Then this man is dusty, disheveled, in a state of poverty-like. The dua should be accepted, he's weak. He raises his hands, begging his creator. Tawheed, he's calling upon Allah. Ya Rabb, my Lord, my Lord. He needs Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He knows Allah is the only one who can help him. But how can this dua be accepted? Because his food, his drink, his clothing, his nourishment was haram. Al-Allama ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, rahimahullah, he said, what is meant by that is that the messengers and their nations were enjoined to eat of good things from halal earnings. That the food they're eating that is halal also is purchased with halal money. And their nations with halal earnings, and to do righteous deeds. So long as one's food is from halal earnings, then righteous deeds will be accepted. But if their food is not from halal earnings, then how can their deeds be accepted? How can the deeds be accepted? This doesn't just mean, okay, I don't eat pork, I don't drink alcohol, this is not what is meant just here. It's that the earnings that you buy that food and that drink and that clothing with is halal, money. The provisions he earned were haram. So his food and his drink and his clothing were haram. When you are not patient in earning the halal and you go to the haram, how can Allah accept your dua? Allah says, now another thing, because we're not just talking about one area of earning it by selling something which is haram and the likes, but also those who engage in riba Allah, he says, يَمْحَقُ اللَّهُ الرِّبَى وَيُرْبِ الصَّدَقَاتِ وَاللَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ كُلَّ كَفَّارٍ أَثِيمٍ. Allah says what means in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, that Allah will destroy riba. He will destroy the usury and the interest, and He will give increase for the sadaqat, for the charity and the alms that are given. And Allah likes not the disbelievers and the sinners. ثُمَّ قَالَ اللَّهُ فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا فَأْذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. And if you cannot, if you do not, if you do not abandon riba, whether you're paying it or you're taking it, if you do not abandon riba or interest, then take a notice of war from Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Who would stand on the other side of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam to fight them? Who would do such a thing? This is for the one who engages in riba. Do not fool yourselves to think that it's allowed because you're in the West, or for whatever reason it may be. Do not fool yourselves. This is a war declared by Allah and His Messenger ﷺ against the taker and the spender and the one who involves himself with riba. Allah says, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ ثُمَّ تُوَفَّى كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَّا كَسَبَتْ وَهُمْ لَا يُظْلَمُونَ. And be afraid of the day when you will be brought back to Allah. Then every person will be paid what he earned, and you shall not be dealt with unjustly in any way whatsoever. تَزَوَّدُوا فَإِنَّ خَيْرِ الزَّادِ التَّقْوَى. So as Allah said, take your provision. But the best provision you can have on a journey and on this journey of this dunya is taqwa of Allah. That's the best provision you can have. To fear your Lord. Keep your duty to Him, so you put a barrier between yourself and the punishment of Allah. أَقُولَ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا لِي وَلَكُمْ فَاللَّهِ يَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ مِنْ. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونصلي ونسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا وبعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this hastiness that we're living in this dunya is from the shaitan. Whenever we go to that outside those doors, it's run, run, run. But we need to slow down these things that Allah told us to do and take the time to do, because the benefit is only for us in this life and the next. There's one more area we want to talk about, because it's definitely becoming a disease in the hearts of the ummah, in the families of the ummah, in the homes of the ummah. And that is the hastiness of the man to say to his wife, I divorce you, or for the wife to ask her husband to divorce her by way of khula. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, فَإِمْسَاكُمْ بِمَعْرُوفٍ أَوْ تَسْرِيحٌ بِإِحْسَانٍ. Allah said, what means, either you retain your wife on reasonable terms, just terms, not just to you, just to her as well, and fairness being due to her, or you release her with kindness. And nowadays, from what we see of the marital relationships, there's no releasing in kindness. You would treat a disbeliever, an animal, better than you treat the wife you divorce, or the way you treat her in your home. Allah, He says, وَعَاشِرُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ فَإِنْ كَرِهْتُمُوهُنَّ فَعَسَىٰ أَنْ تَقْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَيَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ فِيهِ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in Surah An-Nisa, and live with your wives with honor. Live with them honorably. They are your wives. You have children from them. They are your sisters in Islam. Live with them honorably. Treat them well. If you dislike them, it may be that you dislike a thing and Allah brings through it a great amount of good for you, a great deal of good for you. Abu Huraira, he narrates that his Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَسْتَوْصُ بِالنِّسَاءِ فَإِنَّ الْمَرْأَةَ خُلِقَتْ مِنَ الدِّلَعِ وَإِنَّ أَعْوَجَ شَيْءٍ فِي الدِّلَعِ أَعْلَاهُ فَإِنْ ذَهَبْتَ تُقِيمَهُ كَسَرْتَهُ وَإِنْ تَرَكْتَهُ لَمْ يَزَالُ أَعْوَجْ فَاسْتَوْصُ بِالنِّسَاءِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, in this authentic hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, he said, be kind and treat the women well and nicely, with kindness, with compassion, with gentleness, with mercy, being forgiving. For a woman is created from a rib, and the most curved part of the rib is the upper portion. If you try to straighten it, like many of you think you try to straighten your, you'll break her. You will break it. But if you leave it as it is, it will remain crooked. So treat your women nicely and kindly. This should be applied from the husband towards his wife, from the people towards their parents, towards their mothers, because we're living in a time where it is disgusting to see how the children treat their parents. It is disgusting to see how some men treat their wives. At the same token, the woman shouldn't be so quick that whenever she sees one little thing from her husband that displeases her, or she sees something that, yeah, I mean, they got into a little argument, and she goes, well, I work, I don't need you no more, and she wants to get rid of him. This was also discouraged, actually, yeah, I mean, something was told by the Prophet ﷺ for this person to lose a great reward. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, أَيُّمَا أَمْرَأَةٍ سَأِلَتْ زَوْجُهَا طَلَاقًا فِي غَيْرِ مَا بَأْسٍ فَحَرَامٌ عَلَيْهَا رَائِحَةُ الْجَنَّةِ. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, if any woman asks her husband for a divorce without some strong reason, then the fragrance of paradise will be forbidden from her. The fragrance of paradise, being able to smell the perfumes of Jannah, a distance of 40 years of travel is how far that distance goes. You will not smell that if you ask your husband for a divorce without any strong reason. This hadith is in the Sunnah of Abi Dawood. Sheikh Al-Albani, he authenticated it. So this is not for the woman with a reason whose husband abuses her, or is evil towards her, or he is upon shirk or kufr, or does not pray, or on bid'ah, or upon innovation. These are reasons which are allowed for her to request this khulu, or this divorce from him. This is for the one who said, oh, we had an argument, I want out. I don't need you anymore, I got my degree, I don't need you no more, I want out. This is for this person who asked that, they lose the fragrance, being able to smell the fragrances of Jannah. Abu Huraira, he narrates that the Messenger of Allah, he said, ثَلَاثٌ جِدُّهُنَّ جِدٌّ وَهَزْلُهُنَّ جِدٌّ النِّكَاحُ وَالطَّلَاقُ وَالرَّجْعَةُ. The Prophet ﷺ, he told us in the authentic hadith in the Sunan of Ibn Majah, it is Hassan, he said, there are three matters in which seriousness is serious, but even joking is serious. Because these areas leave people insecure, leave them not knowing where to go, having them not knowing what will come tomorrow. Three matters where seriousness is serious and joking is serious, and you'll be held accountable for it. And nikah, the marriage. At-talaq, the divorce. Or raj'ah, taking the wife back after the first two talaqs from the man if he gets to them. There's no bending in this. So why are we bringing this up? Because of the hastiness, the anger, the short fuses that some of the husbands have or some of the sisters have. Always seeking for divorce or talaq and wanting to get out, not treating each other kindly, not being nice, not being kind, not being gentle, not being merciful and forgiving to one another. We will end with this statement from Shaykh Abu Furayhan, Jameel ibn Furayhan al-Harithi, where he said, some husbands, they do not have any patience, nor any deliberation. They're quick to act, and they become enraged quickly. In reality, this type of man needs a muzzle. You know what a muzzle is? What they put on the animal to force its mouth to be shut so that it can't open or bite somebody. This is what many of the brothers need. A muzzle on their mouth to close it. These were the words of the Shaykh. The type of man who needs a muzzle on his mouth and he needs to learn deliberation and patience. He must learn that marital life is not always a bed of beautiful flowers, and that is not always fertile earth and moist land. Rather, there are thorns in the path. There are floods. There are mountains, meaning there are obstacles. It wasn't just yani that everything's going to be perfect. It is upon the man to embody the role that Allah has placed him in, so he does not display haste, nor does he become irate, angry. So he must be forbearing, patient, measured, seek the aid of Allah. He should not be rash. Anger does not bring forth good. Therefore, as long as Allah has placed divorce in your hand, O slave of Allah, then you be as great as the responsibility. You be as great as the responsibility. So these are beautiful words of advice from the Shaykh regarding this. Do not be hasty with your tongues. Some brothers, I'm going to warn you, because you mention it so much, whether joking or you say, oh, I was angry when I said it. You always have an excuse for why you say it. Some brothers have divorced their wife 30, 40 times. It's haram for them to even be in that marriage. But they don't know because they make so many excuses for themselves just to stay in it. Oh, I was angry. I didn't mean what I said. It wasn't my niyyah. So this is a warning to not be hasty upon these lines, because it is from the shaitan. And as we see the breaking of all these family units, our sisters not knowing their husband really divorced them or not, how she's going to provide for herself or not. Would you want this for your mother? Would you want this for your daughter? Would you want this for your sister? You wouldn't want these things. So be mindful. Again, it goes back to the tongue, but be mindful of your haste. And this message is also for the sister to quickly also ask for a khulaf upon every, you know, disagreement or whatever it may be. Work together. Be kind and merciful with one another. May Allah benefit us and allow us to be of those who are not hasty, but those who are patient with His decree and endure what Allah, what life gives us in all of its ways as a test and a trial, so that Allah may grant us His mercy and make us the inhabitants of His Jannah. Allahumma khfir lil muslimin wal muslimat wal mu'minin wal mu'minat ahya' minhum wal amwat innaka anta sami'un qareeb mujib ad-da'wat ya muqallib al qulub thabbit qulubana ala deenik subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al mursalin walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.